Ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this very exciting celebration of Ethan Locke and his music and the production of his first CD, which is coming out shortly. The picture of it on the back of your programme is the picture for the CD, and he is playing the music that will be in the CD. Ethan is very special to all of us, and this must be his sixth or seventh appearance in this wonderful venue of the Musicians' Room in the Institute for the Formation of Character in this World Heritage Village. And it's a very appropriate place, being a Musicians' Room, to have our concerts and to celebrate with Ethan. And we also have Daniel here for at least the third time, who will explain a bit more about how Ethan and he get about halfway through the concert. So, absolutely delighted, ladies and gentlemen, to welcome Ethan David Locke.
Pardon me while I catch my breath. It's amazing. But now we transition from the established classics, played so stunningly just now, to classics surely yet to come, some of Ethan's own compositions. And I am delighted and deeply honored to have been asked to give a little insight into each of them. But first, please allow me to thank a few people who are very, very important. Our Papa Roger said that the most important person in any piano performance is the piano technician, which Papa Roger, in fact, was. So he would know. Therefore, our first thanks is to Andrew Jameson for keeping this fine instrument in such fine shape. Next, we'd like to thank Ethan's masterful piano teacher, Simon Bottomley, for his unique and penetrating wisdom in preparing such a young talent to render for us this evening some of the most technically demanding works ever composed for the keyboard. And finally, our warm thanks to everyone Music and Lanark Society, especially Jamie Hill, for their continued support and for organizing this illustrious event at such short notice. Oh, and thank you all for joining us this evening, also on short notice. Ethan's first piece for us is Wallace at Lanark, a piece that is familiar to most people here. In fact, it was written for Ethan's first ever full concert right here at the Wallace Festival in New Lanark on Sunday, the 24th of May, 2015. Thanks to Ethan, we didn't actually have to look that up. Ethan was only 10 years old when he composed this piece and played a repertoire that was right on the edge of his capabilities at that time. Our good friend, Andrew Jameson, put Ethan's name forward, and we were so surprised you said yes. To thank you for that wonderful opportunity, Ethan wrote this song. It covers the life of William Wallace, all the love, the tragedy, but most of all, each of the fierce battles of his life and for his life. The song begins in nature, featuring the falls of Clyde, the bird songs, and the forest, every strain of which Ethan recorded in his mind during his walks through these hills. It then proceeds to tell Wallace's tumultuous story and then finishes in the same nature setting as it began, this time with all the violence and tragedy of humanity long forgotten by the river and the forest. Life lesson number one, from death, from dust we come, and to dust.
Thank you. Thank you.
years old when he composed and first performed that piece. Now let's fast forward to the ripe old age of 12 when he composed this next piece, The Misunderstood Life. The central theme of this work is those who are not as they seem. The lion in this song is vividly depicted with a tremendous roar, sharp claws, and large teeth. In fact, everyone thinks he is a ferocious beast. However, this lion is not a monstrous animal. He is gentle and kind. Sadly for him, life is constant turmoil of fleeing from hunters. In the end, the lion proves that he is not the savage beast that most take him for when this gentle lion spares the life of a hunter. Life lesson number 2. If at all possible, don't eat anybody.
Thank you. new appreciation for lions and for hunters. Theme to Apollo. This short song about ancient Greece is meant to be played on the lyre, which is an ancient harp. It is a priest's call to the god Apollo and Apollo's answer. Life lesson number 3. If you are in music school doing an ancient Greece assignment, writing a lyre piece gets you an A+. One of the few who can make the grand piano almost sound like a lyre. Of the Sea. This piece was composed at Sea House, which is a beach town just south of Branburg Castle. Ethan stood for hours on the beach, listening, transfixed to the waves crash and the kittiwakes feed their young. Then his imagination, which is itself one of a kind, ventured under the water to a world of sea creatures of all kinds and sizes, creatures that glow, creatures who glide through the depths with grace, creatures unique to a world that remains hidden underneath the Earth's blue curtain. Life lesson number 4. Go on holiday as often as you can and listen. Cinnamon Swirl, written on the occasion of his uncle's 70th birthday, this piece was originally an improvisation. It is based on the chords of C major and E minor, and features the themes of beauty, dreams, and melancholy. Life lesson number 5. Improvisations can make for tremendously cost-effective birthday presents. Richly nuanced piece of music. Wizard Time. The Big Ben in this, the Big Ben section in this piece has a clock chime going through all 24 key signatures. This section alone used to last over a very long 8 minutes until his family couldn't bear it any longer. And asked if he could get through it just a little quicker. Thankfully, he now does all 24 in just 50 seconds, which, though makes it very much harder to play, also makes it much more impressive. Ethan specifically wrote this piece for a performance in London. He got to play in London because he won the Loretto Piano Competition, and performing in London was part of the prize. Life lesson number 6. Sometimes the reward for doing a good job is doing more work.
Big Ben sound like that? The Haunted Tower.
This song first entered Ethan's head on the 3rd of August, 2015, according to Ethan's nearly infallible recollection. But it didn't find its way onto the piano until the 8th of September of that same year, when Ethan felt that he was finally ready to perform his ideas outside his head. Well, he wasn't. The problem with your imagination, especially Ethan's, is that it is not limited by your 2 hands and 10 fingers, but your body is. This piece consists of 6 movements that we were able to refine into physical reality. There is a 7th movement that was abandoned when Ethan's dad said, "Good grief, you need more hands to do that." And how about we put this off till later? Which they did. I'm not going to sugarcoat this. The story of what is going on is just plain weird. The events that occur are not meant to make literal sense, trust me. Rather, the meaning is conveyed through simple characters, actions, and chronology. Our main character, Sir Trufficus, yes, that's right, S-U-T-R-U-F-I-C-A, Sir Trufficus, and I hope I'm pronouncing that right, is a giant who hides in a deep, dark forest because humans are terrified by his vast size. In this forest, he builds, you guessed it, a dark tower. When pesky giant ants attempt to destroy the tower, he tries to use his huge strength to protect his creation, but unfortunately, he dies. The ants proceed to eat their way into his body in a scene that keeps me up at night. They enter through a hole in his cracked skull and live inside his head, while the humans decide to move into the now vacant tower, or so they thought. For when the giant died, he became a ghost. And after enough time, when his strength was renewed, his spirit takes possession of his corpse and ejects the ants from his body. The ants become frenzied and attack the humans, who are unable to defeat such massive monsters. Sir Trufica attempts to save the humans by battling the ants once again. But Sir Trufica realizes the only way to get rid of the ants entirely is to sacrifice himself. In his final moment, he hurls himself into a bottomless pit, bringing all of the ants with him to their doom. Well, I'm afraid that's the end. There is no happy ending for the giant, other than the joy that comes from doing good for others. Life lesson number 7. Sometimes it is best not to know what a piece of music is really about. Thank you.
volunteers to play three notes each on the piano.
Two volunteers. You don't have to be a musician. You just have to come up and play three notes on the piano, and Ethan will then extemporize on the six notes that he is given. So, who would like to? Yes? Thank you. We have one volunteer and one at the back. Thank you.
Is that exactly what you had in mind when you played that? We have had an absolutely wonderful evening. A real privilege to have been here, to have heard Ethan playing this extraordinary music. I can't wait for the CD to come out, and you will all hear about it on the Music in Lanark website as soon as it is out. And we will have it for sale, I hope, on our concerts here. Ethan, thank you very much indeed. Daniel, thank you very much for your excellent introductions, life lessons, number 1 to 7. And Ethan, thank you very, very much for coming once again, giving us this privilege of your wonderful music. Ethan.